Welcome to Microsoft Australian OEM Team's August 2015 Windows Server Update video recording. The topics that we'll cover during this recording will be focused primarily on Windows Server 2012 Essentials and the cloud integration capabilities and how they can be leveraged with new platforms such as the recently released Windows 10. So we'll start off with the current edition, which is Windows Server 2012 R2. And just remember that it's available as part of the standalone Windows 2012 R2 Essentials product, and that it's also an installable role in Windows Server 2012 R2 Standard and Data Center as well. So if you're in a situation where you need these capabilities in an environment of a lot more users than what you've got, allowed inside of Essentials, which is 25, this will actually take that up to around a 100 user and 200 device limit. So it really allows you to start taking it into much larger customers. Then we'll move on and talk about some of the things that have changed with Windows Server 2016 Essentials, at least what we can see in Tech Preview 3. So the good news there to start off with is anyone who is familiar with 2012 R2 Essentials is going to be very comfortable moving into 2016 Essentials. Then I'll move on to some of the ways that we can leverage some of those cloud integration services that Essentials provides us and start leveraging them inside of Windows 10. And then I'll move on to some of the upcoming technical events that you can register for. And finally, we'll wrap up with some of the useful resources that will make sure you're getting the latest information from the Australian OEM team. So first up, moving on to Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials. This product has been available in various forms since the 2011 versions. And if we take a look at the key pillars of the product, it's really all about things, three key pillars. So first of all, protecting your data. So simplified backup for both the server as well as client PCs, built-in disaster recovery capabilities, including things such as the ability to backup into directly into Azure. So this is something that obviously as we move into a world where connectivity is becoming more and more prevalent in a lot of locations, the ability to have these off-site backups automatically generated for us is very, very important. We've got the ongoing simplified management capabilities. So effectively what was started with Small Business Server many years ago now continues to move forward with Windows Server Essentials in terms of a much simplified dashboard that provides a very user wizard-driven approach to making sure that you can go through and perform some very complex tasks with a minimal amount of capability required to know what's really going on underneath the covers. Now, moving on to providing secure remote access. Important things here are that you've got things such as you've still got your VPN capabilities, you've still got the remote web access capabilities that Small Business Server introduced. So this means that you've got a variety of methods of allowing users to connect back into the organization depending on what their requirements are. And now, the final component here is the integration of Microsoft Online Services. So this means that we can start integrating products such as Office 365, Microsoft Azure Active Directory, some of the other online services such as CRM Online and Microsoft Intune, and have these very easily integrated into the dashboard so that when we do things such as add a new user into the environment, it's very easy for us to start adding additional licenses to those users so that they can go through and effectively get signed up and know that they've got the same user ID that they can use locally or in the cloud to sign in and get access to these different resources. So for those of you who really do want to start digging in a bit more into Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials, or even if you've got a burning desire to learn more about the upcoming 2016 edition, what I'd really suggest is starting off by taking a look at the online training material that's available up on Microsoft Virtual Academy. So there's around 4 hours of video content. There's additional assessments that you can take so that you can sort of get an idea of what's in there. And if we take a look, there are seven different topics or seven different modules included in this online training. And you've got the overview, you've got deployment options and licensing, you've got installation, migration and getting started, server management and monitoring, cloud integration and add-ons, the user and computer management, and user experience. So even if it's just a particular module that you're interested in to begin with, you can go up and take a look at what's there and really start preparing yourself for what's going to be coming in the future versions as well if you aren't aware of, you know, what Windows Server Essentials can currently deliver. Now, what's also important with the material up inside of Virtual Academy is that you can very easily go through and download that for offline viewing as well. So you can download it in a variety of video sizes so that if you want it on your tablet or on your phone or on your PC, you can go through and choose the appropriate video, watch it offline so that you don't need to be constantly connected to the internet in order to learn more about that. So before we go any further, let's jump in now and have a quick look at Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials so you can get an idea of what's actually included with the product. And what I'll be focusing on here primarily is just some of the user interface capabilities and the online services integration. So in this demonstration, I'll just quickly show you some of the capabilities that we've got inside of Windows Server Essentials, but we'll jump in and take a look at a few more of the capabilities in the next demonstration, which is going to be showing Windows Server Essentials, but what's been updated in the 2016 edition. So first of all, if we take a look at the dashboard, for those of you who have used Small Business Server or previous versions of Windows Server Essentials, you'll see here that we've got a very similar looking experience in terms of the layout and the UI for the dashboard. And just sort of giving you an idea of some of the things that we can manage in here, obviously we've got the home screen where we can start working our way through. We can take a look at the server configuration status to see, you know, what the additional steps are that we may need to take a look at. As you'd expect, we carry forward with things like the health monitoring and the health reporting capabilities, the ability to go through and easily add in new users, managing the devices on the network, managing local storage, and managing the add-in applications. Now, with both the devices and the storage capabilities, these both start getting extended if we do start enabling some of the integration capabilities with online services such as Office 365. So things like our SharePoint Online storage, for example, might start showing up under storage. And then under the devices section, what we will also start seeing is devices that are connecting into our Office 365 environment for email, for example, will also start appearing under this. So if we go back to the homepage and we do just take a quick look at some of the capabilities that we've got here under services, we've got the Microsoft Online Services integration, and yeah, this is just a quick overview before we jump in and do a bigger demonstration of this in the next demonstration piece. What you'll see is that we've got the ability to integrate with Azure Active Directory. We've got the ability to integrate with Office 365. We can also integrate with Intune. Now, with the Azure AD and Office 365 integration, these are basically things that we can start putting in some, you know, user account synchronization, etc. And with Office 365, we can do some basic management of SharePoint sites, enabling mailboxes. We can assign licenses. And with Intune, we can do some similar things. We can assign licenses, create new users. And then the other one in here, which was added with this version of Essentials, was the ability to go through and start integrating with Azure Backup. Now, obviously, with the backup capabilities, you do need to make sure that you do have the required upstream bandwidth as well as the required downstream bandwidth if you do need to do restores. But the other option that we've got down here in terms of other integrations is, you know, we can integrate with, you know, your on-prem Exchange server if you do have one of those. So that's one of the things here is that, you know, even though Essentials does not include Exchange server, if you do still have an Exchange server on-premise, then that means that you do have the ability to start to go through and start integrating with that. So that's really just a quick look at the Windows Server Essentials dashboard. The other thing that I'll just quickly show you here is that, you know, this is still it is still Windows Server, so things like if I wanted to run Server Manager, for example, to take a look at what's actually happening on this server, if you're familiar with Server 2012 or 2012 R2 Standard or Data Center Editions, you'll see that, you know, this is basically that the same capabilities that we get there. But what we see here over on the left-hand side are some of the default components or roles or features that start being added in during the Essentials installation. So we've got certificate services, we've got domain services, it sets itself up as a DNS server. We can see the file and storage services so that if we did want to go through and start setting up storage spaces, for example, we could go through and start setting that up based on the storage pools that we've got there. Now, for things like remote web access, obviously that's leveraging capabilities of IIS, and then we also do have that Essentials role capability that's installed. So if we just jump up and take a look at the dashboard, and we take a look here for those, for those of you who really aren't that familiar with Server Manager just yet and have been primarily working with previous versions of Server Manager, which were in 2008 R2 and earlier. Some of the important things to highlight here is that we can do things like very easily add or remove roles and features. So if we do role-based or feature-based installation, what you'll see here is as we go through, we could select from, if we did have multiple servers, we could add those in quite easily. We can just pick the roles that we want and add them in. And what you'll see here is that in this case, because this is Windows Server Essentials, we don't get a choice. It's something that is installed as part of the default installation, and we can't actually choose to uninstall that from here. Now, so you can see that there are some additional roles that that are enabled, that are installed. You'll see here that we've got the ability to go through, start adding some additional file server capabilities. If we wanted to add WDS or WSUS, these are options that are available in there. Now, other things we can do is if we do have applications that require updates to .NET Framework, for example, we can add those .NET Framework builds in here. And obviously, there's quite a few other things that you can install in Windows Server. But, as has been the trend over successive versions of Windows, it's really only the required roles and features that do get enabled during the installation. Rather than trying to install everything so that you can discover it all, the idea now is just to keep everything a bit tighter, keep the memory footprint smaller, and make sure that it's a more secure environment that is going out to your users. So I'll just cancel out of that, and we'll jump back into the presentation just quickly so that you can we can talk a little bit about what's changing with Windows Server 2016 Essentials. So that's just gone into preview. So let's finish up this demonstration here and we'll move into the next portion of the presentation. Now that I've given you a quick look at Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials, let's just spend a moment talking about what's coming up in Windows Server 2016 Essentials. So you can grab this evaluation version. You can just grab it from microsoft.com/evalcenter. And obviously, once you sign in there, you'll see that there are quite a few other evals that you can download for the different flavors of 2016 Server that are coming up. But if this is really what you focus on, just grab that one, because you'll still be learning a lot about the other versions of Windows Server by evaluating this version. So what stays the same? Well, from a look and feel perspective, it's very, very similar. You're going to transition from one to the other very easily. And the good news, though, is that there are some major enhancements, even in the current version. And probably the big two here that are worth discussing are focused on some of the additional online capabilities. And whereas we did have the Azure backup option inside of the 2012 R2 version, this has now been extended, or additional Azure services are now being offered, because Microsoft has been offering more SMB focused services inside of Azure. So some of the big ones in there, probably the first one that is going to be quite useful for a lot of organizations, is the Azure Virtual Network integration. So this means that if you do need to deploy a workload, so there may be virtual machine workloads that you do need to deploy in Azure, for example, you can very easily go through the console, through the dashboard wizards, and set up Azure Virtual Networking in a very, very simple manner. And it will go through and do all the heavy lifting for you. And if you do need to go and customize that, you can still jump into the Azure portal and make the adjustments as needed. But to begin with, it just makes it very easy for you to go through and build out this virtual infrastructure inside of Azure, so that if you do have workloads that you need to run there, they'll make it very easy for you to do so. Now, the second piece that I've highlighted here is the Azure Site Recovery integration. So this is really all about taking advantage of the ability to start replicating the content of your machines or your virtual machines up into Azure, and effectively they're stored inside of Azure as offline VMs, so that if you do ever need to switch over to that environment in case of a disaster recovery scenario, you can go through and switch over and really only start incurring the costs for running those virtual machines when you are actually running them. So there are going to be some networking costs, there are going to be some storage costs associated with just having them sitting there in a powered off state, but those costs really aren't going to be very much compared to the peace of mind that can be provided by having this this alternate infrastructure ready to go in case there is a disaster. So here I'm inside of a virtual machine running Windows Server 2016 Tech Preview 3, as you can see here. So what I'll just do now is walk you through just a few things so you can see what's the same, what looks a bit different. And mind you, at this point, they haven't released a full set of details in terms of all of the capabilities. So let's just go through and take a look at some of the things. First of all, starting off with the Windows Server Essentials dashboard. Now, if you were at the roadshow, you would have seen some of these details previously, but you can see that it's got the same look and feel, so it's broken down into the same categories across the top. Down the bottom, we've got setup, services, quick status, and help. What we'll focus on for this one is we'll start off just with the services, and you can see here that we've got the Azure AD, Office 365, and Intune integration, along with the Azure Backup integration capabilities that we had in the past. But what we've also got is the Azure Virtual Network and the Azure Recovery pieces. So to begin with, just let me go through and configure the Azure Active Directory integration. And that should be a fairly short process. So we just choose Integrate with Azure AD. And I'll just provide my sign-in details. Now, this account needs to be a global admin in your Office 365 or Azure Active Directory environment. And I'll just click on Next. We need to apply a strong password policy because obviously we don't want weak passwords either on-prem or especially up in the cloud. Now, you'll see that it started populating information in terms of what it's retrieved. So we've got quite a few details down on the right-hand side around the different subscriptions in terms of the number of licenses that have been consumed. So we can see the number that are available. We can see the expiry dates. We can see the primary DNS details, etc. But also just in the wizard itself, you can see that it just gives a quick view that I've got two different subscriptions here. I've got the Office 365 E3 plan, and I've also got the Enterprise Mobility Suite, which, as you'll see in a few moments, includes Intune, Azure Active Directory Premium, and the Rights Management Service. Now, it will tell me that I need to go through and enable the password synchronization. It tells me that I will need to restart this server, so I'll just go through and do that quickly. So I won't get you to sit there and watch that whole process, so I'll cut that out of the recording, and then we'll come back in after the server has been restarted. Okay, this might actually start up quicker than I thought, so maybe I don't need to cut anything out. So we'll just let this run for a little bit longer. And now we're back at the login screen for the server. So let's go back in and we'll both go back into the Essentials dashboard. And what I'll also do here is just enable the Office 365 integration component and the Intune integration component. So now that we've already enabled the Azure AD integration, it means integrating Office 365 is a simple process. It realizes that we're already signed in with those details we saw previously, so we can just configure that. And what that configuration will do is just take us to the tab where we can see the Office 365 integration details. We can see some of the information around the E3 license, so we can see that this is something I'll have to renew in less than a year. We can see email details here. Now, if I go back to the home page, what we can then do is go back to services, and now I'll enable Intune. Now, with the Intune integration piece, again, we'd be using the same user identities that we're using for Office 365 and Azure Active Directory. So it's just a matter of enabling that. But what you'll see here is that we don't have a page inside of here to manage Intune. Instead, it would tell us to go to the portal. So the next steps are to go through and add a new user in. So I've already got my own account in there. So let's go through and add a new user account, and I'll call it Essentials User, and I'll give them a complex password. And it looks like everything matches. Now, what you'll see here is that I've still got the ability to go through and choose which, what do I want as the sign-in slash email address for that user. And obviously, it's going to be better for the user if I do use the real URL or domain name rather than the onmicrosoft.com. But alternatively, I could go through and assign an existing user account to that one. So if I've already got a few users set up in that environment, I could assign them to that user account. Or I could choose not to assign it because it may just be an on-premises user who doesn't need that account. So I'll just click Next on that and create the new account. This way we get to pick and choose all of the licensing capabilities for the user. So in this case, what we don't want is we don't want the Azure Rights Directory capabilities, and we also don't want the Office 365 Intune capabilities, because instead we'll use the full MDM capabilities of Intune that we've got here. So the other options look okay, so I'll just I'll get rid of that one and enable that one. So we'll just go next. This is just an end user, so that they don't need access to the server dashboard, but we can still give them remote web access. So important to note, remote web access is still in Essentials 2016. So now we go through, it connects into the cloud service, it will create the user and then go through multiple steps of assigning all of those individual licenses out to that user. So if you're adding multiple users, you can see that it's something that really will start saving a bit of time for you. Now, just to see what's going on with the Essentials user, what we can see first of all from the dashboard is we can see that they're in here as a standard user, and they also do have an Office 365 account there as well, and we can sort of very easily see what the details are. Now, just to verify that I have given the Essentials user the right permissions or the right licenses inside of Office 365 and the Enterprise Mobility Suite, let's just take a look in here and see what we've got. So again, this is all dynamic. It's querying the service to get a real-time view of what this user has actually got available to them. So this is something that can take a few seconds depending on internet connectivity speeds. Because I've just provisioned the user as well, it may also just take a few extra seconds for it to complete the processes that I just initiated a minute or so ago. So we'll just give that another few seconds to run, and then we will be able to see what's happening with that. Okay, so here we are. So you can see here, if I wanted to add additional email addresses, I could do that. So if we did have multiple domain names that we were using for external communications, I could easily add those into this environment. Now, we can also see that those different licenses that I have assigned are also available in here as well. So that's all well and good, so I can hit OK. So now it's a matter of moving on to something that's new inside of here, which is the Azure virtual networking. So I won't cover Azure backup or Azure recovery in this this month's update. We'll save that for a future one. Instead, let's just take a look at the Azure virtual networking so you can get an understanding of some of the scenarios where you may want to look at this. So first of all, I want to integrate with Azure virtual network. And in this case, you know, we don't need to use that same ID to sign in. We may be using a different ID to sign into our Azure overall tenant to what we've got as a global admin for Azure. So in this case, I'm going to use a different sign-in, but you can still see that it's an onmicrosoft.com email address, sign-in account. And I do have multiple Azure subscriptions set up here, so I'll just choose the first one, Visual Studio Premium one, because I've actually done a little bit of work in advance to speed this process up. So what we can do here is, first of all, choose where we want the virtual network to be. And in this case, I'm Sydney-based, so I'll choose Australia East. And for the Azure virtual network, one that I created in advance was called TP3 Test for Tech Preview 3 Test. And the local network that I'd already configured was TP3 Local. So these are ones that once I've completed this, you'll see the settings that it automatically chose. So I didn't have to do, you know, any configuration of IP, for example, to get this working. Instead, it just said, do I want to use my Windows server as the VPN server, or do I have a hardware device that will need to be configured as the VPN server into Azure via a site-to-site network. So I'll just hit OK on that one. And here we can see use Windows Server as the VPN server or use my VPN router. I'll keep it simple here and I'll just select Windows Server. So now as I click on Finish here, we can see that inside of Azure, it's got the virtual network address space of 10.0.0.0 all the way through to the 255 range. So obviously it's quite a large range and you can go into the Azure portal online and start breaking that down into smaller subnets if you want. So there's no problem whatsoever with you doing that. And any of you who've already played around with Azure virtual networking will already be quite familiar with how to do that. Now you can also see here what my local network address space is. You can see the local DNS server, which is this system itself, as well as the local public IP address. So I'll just hit OK on that. So now it's going through and configuring this. And this can take a couple of minutes to run. So to sort of show you before and after, just let me open up a command prompt. And I'll also fire up remote desktop. A remote desktop client, because I've already got a virtual machine provisioned up inside of Azure. So while that's being provisioned, if I try to ping that server, you can see that nothing's happening. I'm not able to get through to it. If I try to use remote desktop services to get through to it, so what you'll see here is that I actually did get a response on that final one, so it's connected. It's telling me, you know, over the life cycle of the connection, how much data has already been transferred. Now, just to really give you an idea of what's going on here, if I just ping that, okay, we'll see that we've got this one. Now, if I go over to this machine here, and I again type in the domain admin details, what I'm showing you here is that this is because I'd already had this network running before I went through this scenario for you and disconnected it and then reconnected. I've kind of jumped ahead a few steps, but I've done that deliberately so you can actually see that the remote server that I've connected into that's sitting inside of Azure is actually already, you know, I've already gone through, I've done a domain join with that, for example. So if this is a workload that I wanted to run inside of Azure that I didn't want to run on-premise, for example, because there are a whole bunch of different Azure virtual machine templates that you may find useful or different workloads that you do want to run remotely, this is a very easy way for you to go through and get that set up. So you can see that I'm able to RDP into it using the internal IP address, whereas normally if you're setting something up inside of Azure and not connecting the networks, you'd need to be connecting into it via the public IP address and a differently mapped port for getting into RDP access. So if I just minimize this, the other thing that I'll show you now that we've got, you can see that I've already got a domain joined machine in here. What I can also do now is go through, if I go back to the start menu and I select Server Manager, because we've essentially got this set up as a site-to-site VPN connection, I've only got one server. I've got the essential server added in here at the moment. What I can do now is go up to the dashboard. I can add another server to manage. And you can see here that, you know, because this is a domain joined server, so I can add the server in. And, you know, obviously this is one of the things that we focused on a bit during the roadshow. Now that's a server that I can go through and manage and launch the management tools from within this local server that I'm administering. So if I go into Active Directory, well, I've only got one AD server, so I'm only going to get reports from one. But that other server, it really doesn't have too much on it apart from some file services. So what you can see here is that I can now go through and perform the file management. So if I go down to disks, okay, and we can see for server one, if I do a refresh on this. You can see here that now that secondary server that I set up, if I want to go through and do some disk configuration, see how much storage is available, if I wanted to enable data deduplication, I could go through and remotely start configuring that. So there's quite a bit that we can do now that we've got the Azure virtual networking environment connected into our own local network. So effectively from a user perspective, if they're on our local domain, they can go through and connect into local resources and these remote Azure resources. The only real difference is going to be the speed of what it is they're trying to achieve over the high speed local network versus what the customer internet connectivity speed will be. So that ends the Windows Server Essentials portion. And yeah, I just wanted to give you a quick overview of some of the little changes, some of the things that are new, but also showing you that, as you'd expect, based on conversations we've been having for the last couple of years, the big message here when we do look at Essentials or we look at Windows Server, it's not a cloud versus an on-prem conversation. It's how do you leverage the benefits of on-prem, how do you manage the benefits of cloud-based services and bring them together as a better solution for your customers. So let's get out of the Windows Server portion of the demonstration now. So now moving on to some of the changes that have been occurring down on the client side. So while there are quite a few different things around Windows 10 that can be covered, probably the main thing just to keep things aligned with what we're talking about here with Windows Server Essentials is that we can start leveraging some of those online capabilities that we assign to users inside of Essentials directly from Windows 10 clients. And those Windows 10 clients don't even need to be joined to the local Active Directory domain, or they don't even need to be connected into the Windows Server Essentials environment. So the scenario that I'll run through in the demonstration will cover off just an out-of-box experience, a machine that's connected to the internet. So you can see that I can sign into that machine and have it automatically provisioned as part of my organization and start getting some policies such as password requirements, etc., applied to that. Just through a mobile device management capability that could be being provided by Intune, or it could be provided by the Enterprise Mobility Suite if you're using that, or even just the MDM capabilities that Office 365 provides. So there's quite a bit that you can start doing here so that we're in a world where more and more people are connecting more devices that don't really need to connect to our internal network. And this is all about making it easier for you to still start getting some corporate control over those without it being as restrictive as what you may have to enforce if they do try to domain join the device. Now, some of the changes that have occurred here, and some of these are quite recent. So the ability to join during the out-of-box experience on a Windows 10 device, or alternatively, we can go into the system properties and we can join after setup is complete. So if the user doesn't get it during the deployment of the new machine when they set it up for the first time after unboxing it, no problem. They can just jump into system and run through the process and it's quite fast. Now, what's been added recently is if the user does have an Intune license assigned to them, and that's something that you saw during the demonstration of Essentials, that I did assign an Intune license. It means that now that user can automatically have the device enrolled in Intune for Intune MDM capabilities. So we're really trying to make it as easy as possible to get these devices compliant with the corporate requirements, even before they go anywhere near the corporate network. So this is something that is enabled by default now, but obviously you do need to have the Intune licenses in order to do that. So the scenario that you'll see in this demonstration is all around, you know, non-Active Directory domain joined machines. So primarily it could be a BYOD or a roaming device that lives off the network. You know, signing in for the first time, but being able to just join as your Active Directory and register itself and then start getting these mobile policies. So instead of talking about it, let's just jump in and take a look so you can see what's actually involved. So now on a Windows 10 virtual machine that's just finishing up the out-of-box experience, one of the offerings that we get at the moment on Windows 10 Pro and Windows 10 Enterprise devices is we get a chance of actually either signing into an organization account at the beginning or saying that it's our own personal device. Now, if I select my organization, what this means is that it will give me the option of going through and either signing into a traditional Active Directory domain, so signing into our normal domain, doing the PC domain join for us, or alternatively, we can join as your Active Directory. Now, where this is important is if we've got Windows 10 devices such as this one that really aren't going to be on the corporate network, or it might be more of a BYOD type scenario, this means that we can actually start getting some mobile device management capabilities pushed out to the device either by you know, some of the combinations that you can get through as your Active Directory. Microsoft Office 365 includes a subset of Intune MDM capabilities, as well as Intune itself's capabilities. So in this case, if I choose join as your AD, what I'll do here is I'll sign in as that user. So remember that the user that I used in that last example was Essentials user at emsauspoc.com. And the password was a complex one, so hopefully I've typed that in correctly. Now what you'll see here is that I've already done some customized branding in this Azure AD or Office 365 tenant, where it's already going through and actually providing me like just a small logo and a little bit of customized text that might make it a bit more assuring for customers that they are doing the right thing when they're signing in. So then I just click sign in. And if all of the networking is configured properly, etc., for us at this point in time, it means that we should be able to go through and have a device that we can automatically enroll in Azure AD using the Azure AD device join capability. So that means that things like mobile device policies that will enforce password complexity, whether you want alphanumeric or just PIN, how complex you want them, if you want like a 4-digit PIN versus 6-digit PIN, that's really just the tip of the iceberg in terms of what you can actually do here. So here you can see that now it's welcoming me as this user. So this has successfully set me up in this case. And now it needs to go through and do the normal Windows 10 application or built-in apps set up, etc., do a few customizations. So this won't take too long. So we'll just pause this while this occurs, and then we'll come back in as we've gotten to the end of this. So you don't need to watch this entire process. So I can go through and just say create the PIN. So we can see that little message that popped up just gave us information that the machine was about to be registered. So here we can take a look at what the PIN requirements are. We can see minimum length is 4. And basically you can see that letters aren't allowed. So we're only enforcing 4-digit PINs. So I can just select a 4-digit PIN here. And these are policies that over on the online services side, I can make much more complex if I need to. But if we're really just trying to get you people used to the idea of some of this, we may not want to start things too complex to begin with. So that's it. So that's an out-of-box setup. So I can just now go through, and if we take a look at the settings here, the way that we can tell that this is actually now a device that is joined is if I go to About in System, you'll see here that it's telling me that I'm connected to the organization. Now, what I just want to highlight here though is that if you go to the traditional area where you can find this information, such as going into System, you'll see here that it's still technically in a work group. So even though it's done in Azure Active Directory domain join, that's not the same as a machine ID being associated and a user ID being associated with your on-premise Active Directory. So this is an alternative way of getting devices enrolled and registered and starting to get some capabilities over them without them having to be participating in your local network security. Instead, it's cloud-based network security that's being delivered. So that's just a really quick look at what I wanted to show you here. So we'll go back to the presentation. So, what else is happening and what should you be aware of in terms of upcoming events? Well, obviously there's a lot of new products coming from Microsoft. So we've got new versions of Windows Server. So even though we've only focused on the Windows Server Essentials updates for this section, in the next video update, we will be focusing heavily on Windows Server 2016, because obviously there is a fair bit to start talking about there. But some of the upcoming events that you should be made aware of, first of all, Ignite Australia. So those of you who are familiar with the what used to be called TechEd, well, it's back on the Gold Coast. It's a four-day event. It runs from November 17 to November 20. So this is something that normally sells out quite quickly. So if you are planning on attending or you do have staff that you were thinking of sending along, then definitely, you know, register. You can go to this site now and register your interest. And as soon as you get a chance to register, I definitely would recommend it. Now, what you'll see is that for some of these, including Ignite, I do have an asterisk next to some of the activities. So what I'm highlighting here are the events that will have representation from the local OEM team at these events. So if you are heading along to these, you know, let us know through the resources we'll mention on the next slide, so that we can, you know, we can have a meet and greet. Probably shouldn't say maybe we can catch up for a beer if that's the kind of thing you need to do, because I'm sure that something like Ignite on the Gold Coast, I've got a feeling that could be a possibility. Now, the other events that we've got listed here, first up, we've got 3 days of Windows 10 deep dive training. So this is happening in Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane. So before anyone takes a look at some of the dates and thinks, hang on, it looks like there's an error here. The event runs in Sydney on the 23rd to 25th of September, and then it's being repeated on the same days but in different cities, so Melbourne and Brisbane the week after, or a few days after the Sydney one. So I'll be at the Sydney event and the Brisbane event, and there'll be alternate people delivering the session in Melbourne. So again, if Windows 10 is an important part of what you do, and I'm guessing if you're listening to this or watching this, it probably is. So it's worthwhile learning what's really going on under the covers rather than just sort of seeing people talking about the cosmetic changes that we see on the surface. Then finally, the schedule for the Modern Biz technical events, which have been running for about a year. The schedule for this year's events have just been released, and it was actually quite a coincidence. This morning, we actually got the updated details around what the modules are, what's being covered, what's been updated. So these have been are being updated quite dramatically from last year's content, which, you know, as you'd expect, it makes sense. And it's really not something that's optional, because especially anything that deals with cloud technologies, well, that stuff moves much faster than on a year-by-year basis. And with Windows 10 out, it means all of the Windows 8.1 content just doesn't need to be there anymore. And we've got, you know, updates to Hyper-V, updates to Windows Server, updates to Essentials. So effectively everything, you know, will have changed from last year. So it means that even though you may see some of the topics look similar, if you have attended before but you want to keep up to date on the latest versions, take a look at these and you'll see that, you know, a couple of these are running in a few cities. So, if we take a look, Safeguard Your Business is running in Adelaide, Brisbane, Melbourne, Perth, and Sydney. So, apologies to Darwin and Canberra. We're not getting to you with this one, but if this is the kind of thing you're interested in, take a look and register early, because again, these are ones that do tend to book out early. Now, there is also, from what we're hearing, a full day of Windows 10 training as part of these series, which is more SMB focused, coming up, but we don't really have any more details around the dates or the content on that one just yet. So I'd suggest keeping an eye on the blog site, where we will be keeping you up to date on this, because as soon as this information is up there, we'll make sure it gets out to you. So now, wrapping up, what resources should you be paying attention to? Well, from the OEM team's perspective, really it's three primary pieces. First up is SmartHQ, which is our site for resellers, OEMs for system builders, so that if you deal with OEM versions, licensing, etc., this is really the place to go. So microsoftsmarthq.com.au, take a look and see what useful information you can grab from there. Now, we've also got the Microsoft Australia OEM team blog site. So this is primarily relating to OEM and SMB focused technologies. But in this day and age, when more of these things are becoming more and more intertwined with other solutions, we can't really just focus on one without making sure that we do talk about the interaction and the benefits that other solutions integrating with it do provide. So keep an eye on that site as well. We do very regular updates to that. And then finally, for pre-sales information for Microsoft OEM server products, we do have the OEM server AU at microsoft.com email address as well. So that if you do need to contact us regarding solutions based on OEM server licenses, for example, from a pre-sales perspective, shoot through an email and we'll be able to get back to you shortly on that. So that really wraps up everything that we have got to cover off this month. So I'd like to thank you all for watching the presentation, and hopefully you'll get some useful information out of those different resources and the new pieces of information that we've shared this month. So thank you very much for that.